Good morning, good morning. This is Brenda Perryman sitting in for Richard Harrison this morning, wishing Richard well. I have an announcement to make to the WHPR audience. Mr. J.D. Hill of the J.D. Hill Show and owner of African Easy Silk Hair Products made his transition yesterday afternoon, on Sunday afternoon. He passed away. We ask that you send out your prayers to the family. Once again, J.D. Hill, host of one of our television shows here and sponsored other television shows, passed away yesterday. He was such a nice man and a very, very good friend. At half of the hour after I finish interviewing my guest, I will open up the lines for you if you want to call in and say something about JD. Also, I believe the hair doctor is going to have a tribute to JD between 11 and 12 today. So once again, JD Hill, our friend, host, and just a wonderful man of the EEOC philosophy. He passed away yesterday, and he will be greatly missed. Now I'm going to transition into my guest. Let me put a smile on my face for a minute. I couldn't sleep last night thinking about JD, but anyway, this lady has written a book that's very, very helpful, and it's dealing with bullying in the workplace. It's called Position for Power, The Working Woman's Guide to Thriving in Life. And she is here with me, Angeline Lawrence. Good morning.
Good morning, Ms. Perryman. It's a pleasure to be here.
Oh, it's a pleasure for you to be here because, I mean, bullying in the workplace. I think that everyone, and like you say, not only women, but men get bullied in the workplace.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, they do. My book is based on my own experience several years ago and even dealing with things today. And it was a really low point in my career. I was fairly new to the workforce, having been maybe employed maybe 3 years or so and transitioned to a new job.
Right.
And I had to work with a bully. Everyone knew but me. And my background in terms of working and being on a team was quite different from someone that was used to working independently. And they were an older staff person. So you had all these different dynamics going. And I allowed him to get me so upset that I exploded at work. I mean, just a big fallout. And then I was labeled with having anger management issues when I stood up.
When you stand up, you know, to fight back, mm-hmm. you're labeled with anger management issues. Mm-hmm. Wow.
I actually had to attend a class, so I didn't fight it. I said, okay, that's fine. Because everyone knew that this individual was one of the more different people to work with, but everyone dealt with it different. And so what it showed me is that I needed to focus on me. I wasn't concerned about changing this individual, but I took it as an opportunity for personal growth and spiritual growth.
Wow. I think all of us at some time has experienced that. Now, walking into a new workplace is intimidating enough.
Yeah.
You know, you're walking in where everybody knows everybody and nobody knows you.
Right, exactly.
And then it's nice to have everybody be so friendly and stuff. And it's funny because sometimes in the interview, everybody's all friendly, like this is the greatest place to work.
Right.
Then you get to that place
and the
honeymoon is over soon, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So what can we say is a definition of bullying in the workplace? Workplace bullying.
Mm-hmm. I did a lot of research with the Workplace Bullying Institute. So there's actually several, but this one expert defines it as abusive behavior is consistent, is done by one or more persons to one or more persons. And it includes intimidation, humiliation, verbal abuse, work sabotage. So, and it's health harming. And that's really the crux of the definition, is that the environment is so toxic that it impacts your health.
Yes, I could see that. Mm-hmm. I could see that. So for you, I mean, okay, you had been bullied at one time. So you, was this book kind of a catharsis? I mean, kind of let me write this stuff out and show people how I dealt with it and how I succeeded?
You know, I actually interviewed Dr. Gary Nemme, and he's been a workplace bullying expert. He even gave expert testimony, I don't know if you remember, in the NFL with the Miami Dolphin football players. When that whole
thing. I remember that. The football players bullied that one guy.
Yes, and he was an expert, and he told me that showing your voice, lifting your voice and exposing it is the power that you have. And in writing that book, this is the power that I had to give, not only to myself, but to others who are going through. Because there are so many women and men who are, you know, you might be different, you might enjoy your job. And one of the profiles of a target is that you're talented, you stand out, you understand, right?
Oh, God. You know, it makes you, I had never been in quite the situation I was in until I got to Southfield High. I left mm-hmm. Highland Park. I taught Highland Park for mm-hmm. almost 18 years. Mm-hmm. Went to Southfield High. Just a nice school, blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. And then the other support personnel who were supposed to support my drama program, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. they were doing everything to pull the rug from under my program.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so you have kids here, mm-hmm. they're at stake, mm-hmm. and what they can learn. And then you have some people, bullying doesn't have to be big.
No,
it could be undercover stuff, right?
Yes, covert, undermining.
Right.
It's just the little things that are consistent. And if you're not aware, and if you're not if you don't know yourself, you may think that, oh, I caused this. Oh, I must have put my report in the wrong place. But when you know yourself and you have a standard of excellence, then you're able to know, well, I know I turned my report in early. I don't know why it was not completed on time. You know, things like that. And so after that blow up, I use it as an opportunity to grow. I said, you know, that person is going to be
who
they
are. And so when
you
blew up, you yelled and stuff, or
yes,
what?
Yes, and so it's not funny. I could laugh now.
I can imagine, because everybody wants to do it, wants to, how can I fight this without losing my job?
Yeah.
That's an important thing.
I was 7 months pregnant, too. So you had, now I had been dealing with this situation for months. And so my belly is out, and you know, women, I'm not going to paint us as just always emotional, but I was tired. And he accused me of changing his report, which I had not done. And he did it loudly, and he humiliated me. And I'm just like, really? I've been trying to work with you all this time, you know? And I just snapped. And I was like, you know, I don't have to take this. And I just went on and on, and they called it the Big Smackdown. That was the name. And we laughed about it.
Well, I'm sure everybody wants to know, what kind of business were you in this particular, don't name the business, but what kind of business?
I was a city planner. So I worked in, my experience goes from the private industry to also the public industry. And so I was working in a city at the time, and doing city planning.
Okay.
And in that industry, you can be an independent worker or you work on teams, but my experience had always been working on teams, you know, and you deal with things within your team. It doesn't go outside of that.
Right.
And you get the job done. But that wasn't happening in this case.
Now, was there a team leader?
Well, that was part of the problem.
Oh.
He didn't want to be the team leader, but then he didn't want me to lead. So as I'm trying to work with, and they were older than me, you know, so it was just constant. I'm like, well, okay, then you lead. But then he didn't know how to lead. But then you didn't want me to lead. So there was this constant tug of war.
Tug of war. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you have in your notes that you gave me that 80% of bullying is legal.
That's right. Yes, that's right.
Did you hear that? 80% of bullying is legal?
That's what, right.
Tell me about it.
Because same gender or same sex and same race or ethnicity harassment or misbehavior is not illegal. It's not, by definition, it's not illegal. And currently there aren't any laws against workplace bullying. So they have the Healthy Workplace Bill that they're working in different states to try and introduce. I believe Maryland actually introduced the bill to look at the health harming impacts that it has on workers who are bullied. But it's legal. And that's part of the problem that many have.
They could get away with so much.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And, you know, some of the impacts, I know for myself, I would lose sleep. I would talk about my job in my sleep. My husband's like, honey, wake. I'm talking about work in my sleep. You know, I get headaches. And I knew I had to change when I realized my core was being impacted, the core of who I am.
Yeah.
And that I wasn't happy. I was always upset. I'm like, that's not who I am. And I knew that I had to make a change.
Right. And we really, really, I mean, it's like harassment, but you, oh, and we have a call. Good morning. Hello?
Because
Hello?
We can't hear the young lady. She needs to talk up because we can't hear at all.
Oh,
so
okay.
I'll just call
okay.
And let you know that.
Let's speak up. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so what was that last thing you were talking about? It had got you in your core.
Yes.
The bullying. Mm-hmm. Okay. And 60% of the targets are women.
Correct. And the majority of the targets are, the perpetrators are women against women.
Women against women.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Well, you know. Sometimes we do that to each other as opposed
yeah.
to supporting.
Yeah. Unfortunately, some women feel threatened by other women and mm-hmm. probably do that. I had never had that mm-hmm. Personally, but mm-hmm. I could see it happening. Mm-hmm. And I think about the fact that one of my former panelists of my other show, he was with the EEOC, the Mm-hmm. Employment mm-hmm. Opportunity Commission.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And you can file with them.
Yes, you can. But you have to document everything. You have to keep documentation. You have
yes.
to almost like keep a journal when events happen. The way that you can really get an employer or to make a case is that if you have a disability
yes.
and they deny you time off, and that's one form of harassment, then those are things that you can use to go to the EEOC. In my case, it was harder to prove. And going to a lawyer was not an option for me. But you have this huge blowout, and I did learn how to keep records, document everything that I did so that there wouldn't be any issue as to whether I was doing my work.
Okay, so let's talk about this real quick, and you kind of mentioned it before. What is the profile of a target, a person who is that people choose to bully?
Okay, so there are two types of profiles. One, you're either younger, you're more technical on your job, you have a lot of abilities, people like you, you're very likable, and you can get the job done. The other is that you're like a senior level staff person. You're the go-to person. You've been there. You know how to get things done. And you kind of maybe intimidate your supervisor because you have the experience and the background. And sometimes the supervisors aren't as technical.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes they are. But those are really the two types of profiles, that you're highly skilled and you're likable and you have a standard of excellence and you get things done.
So what is the profile of a bully? A person, okay, we all could go back to childhood and bullying. Mm-hmm. And I remember third grade, this guy named Bald-Headed Baldini, that's what I called him. But, I mean, he was just a bully. I don't know for what. but he was just a bully, and he came up on my porch, and me and my little friend, we were playing, and he just started hitting us. And so we started hitting back, and we knocked him off the porch, and he ran home. But what makes somebody a bully? If anybody out there knows, let me know. But what makes somebody a bully, you think?
Well, there are four types of bullies, and I've met each and every one of them on any most of the jobs I've gone to. And I'd say the first one is what we call the gatekeeper.
The gatekeeper.
That's the individual who has access to resources. They are in the direct line with authority. So they have a relationship with authority. Most times maybe they're administrative or maybe they're another supervisor. But they have access to everything that you need to get your job done. And at will, they can deny that and then end up sabotaging you because they're not giving you information that you need, technical information that you might need to do your job, training, they're withholding information about training for you, maybe a software you need on your computer, and they're withholding that or they give it to someone else.
Here's a call. Good morning. Hello?
Good morning. How are you?
Fine. If we could turn it up some, fella, I can't hear it.
Oh, I'm talking too slow. Let me speed it up.
Pardon? Wait just a second. I can't hear you very
well. I would say most bullies are victims of bullying themselves, and they lack self-esteem to a certain level, so they have to act out.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point. Mm-hmm. Very good point. Very good point. I appreciate that.
Okay, ladies. Have a good morning.
Okay, thank you. Good morning.
Hey, good morning, Ms. Perryman. This is 6-4.
Hi.
And hello to your guest.
Good morning. How are you?
All right. I just got, okay, two things. One on the employment thing, and then one on the bullying thing. When I used to work at a certain school in the suburbs, I noticed that bullying was more of a thing that came from home. You know, a lot of bullies in their household, the climate is set for them to be like that because there's no checks and balances for that particular person. And then that person ends up taking that to the community and to the schools and institute that type of behavior against everyone else. Because they're so used to it at home.
So you're
talking. I've seen instances where a kid was actually dead wrong, and the parents would fight tooth and nail.
Right, right. Yes.
That their child was right. In one case in particular, it was a black kid and a Caucasian kid, and the Caucasian kid called the black kid out his name. It wasn't a derogatory name. Well, it wasn't the name you would think. Let me just put it that way. But the black kid thought that it was a name that warned the little white kid getting slapped. So when the parents came up to the school and I was mediating the situation, the mother kept and the father kept saying these words, "How dare him have the audacity to hit my son?" After he said that to him, it's almost like they wanted the black child to give that white child the privilege that they have been giving that child all of his life. I just hate that he had to wake up like that.
Right.
But bullying, a lot of times you have to check the climate of and the mental climate of the parents and why that child feel that they could be that type of child and not fear any kind of repercussions from adults.
Well, sometimes 6-4. Well, let's get back to the workplace, and I have another call. I know you wanted to make another point. I have another call, and I want that person to hold on, please. I'll be with them in a second. But what about people who bully other coworkers? You know.
Now that right there, because I've seen that too, and this is where we as grown-ups have to put our grown folks' hats on. And when we out in this world, we have to remember that we're still in the jungle, too, even amongst other grown-ups on a job. You have a lot of 50-year-olds who are nothing but 13-year-olds
That's
in the mind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They may show you that on their job. Here's what I want to say about the employment. I'm glad she's bringing up a lot of these good points.
Okay.
I want to talk about, you about the when they say that you voluntarily quit your job, the voluntary quit. Mm-hmm. We had a case where there has been times where people have been forced to work overtime. And when they tell their boss they don't want to work overtime, their boss will tell them, if you don't show up for work, that's a voluntary quit. Well, we challenged that, Ms. Perryman, and we found out that that is a forced termination. So if you was ever denied unemployment because you refused to work overtime, you have a recourse to go back and get your unemployment, because the judge ruled in the case that as long as you worked 40 hours, you didn't refuse work. Anything over 40 has to be voluntary. And there are thousands of cases where people did not want to go to work for overtime and was fired, and the company registered it as that person quit. So go back, if you hear my voice, and get your unemployment and let them know the circumstances. When it comes to unemployment, Ms. Perryman, a lot of times as black people, what we don't do is we don't write down the full situation of even how the job handled it, so the courts and the employment commission could see your point too. Challenge that.
Yes, and that's key that we document.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Yes, you said document everything.
Yes, document everything. And
good morning.
Yes.
Hi.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay. Now, I think if you're talking about bullying on the job, what I've seen and observed was that with technology, middle management is being eliminated. They don't need middle management. They're cutting back on middle management. So those bullies primarily on the job are those middle managers have to make themselves have worth. And to make themselves have worth, they bully the worker. And I'm in a case with my daughter who's in the Washington D.C. area, and there she's fighting, I can't name this big company, and she went to EEOC. Right. EEOC is not really fighting those cases that much, because what we see is that when we won the concession to have disability protection for people who's on disability, the Disability Act, well, most companies don't want that. They see that as extra cost. So the supervisors make it very difficult for those workers who are qualified, yet though they have a disability. So those bullying on the job, if your guest can speak to it, I found those two examples, technology and the middle management is not needed and have to make himself have worth. He goes and bullies the workers so they can look at him and give him, awards. But he really should be, according to technology, eliminated. And he's trying to hold on. And
right.
The other is that the companies don't want to pay that disability person and accommodate them.
Yes, sir. That's a very excellent point. And
okay, I'm going to hang up and listen.
Okay, thank you.
That was an excellent point, and many times I had just spoken about that. When you have a disability and your boss or supervisor is trying to withhold you from going on necessary appointments or taking time off that you need in order to take care of yourself, those are opportunities that they can use to try and bully you,
yes.
And those are things that you can document. And in terms of the EEOC, you have to have documentation. You have to keep a journal of everything that you're doing. And it's best not to have anything on your work computer or store files in your workplace.
Right, right. That's
But you need to either email it to yourself, and sometimes they can even go in and pull, I don't know if they can pull it back, but just try and print out everything that you can and have hard copies and keep them off-site, you know. And in terms of middle management, sometimes it's coworkers. They call it mobbing. This is a major epidemic in Europe, and that's really where a lot of the research started in the 80s, was in Europe, because you have groups of people who attack or target one individual. And it's usually don't you get your coworkers, don't talk to such and such today. if you go in the conference room and they go to the other side of the room, or they're not, you know, dealing with you, or they're excluding you from work projects. So it's more than just being in middle management. It can be coworkers, and it can also be supervisors and higher-ups.
Absolutely. It can't. Coworkers, that's the thing. Mm-hmm. That was in my case, and these were two white men. Mm-hmm. And I guess I must have looked weak, but I showed them.
That's right.
You know, but see, I don't mind if, you know, when my back is against the wall, I can't, you know, I got to come out swinging.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And when you're trusting the environment, sometimes we let our guard down, we trust the environment, mm-hmm. and you never know. My mother always says, everyone who smiles in your face is not your friend.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So sometimes it could be that person who's smiling in your face sees what you're doing, sees how you're achieving, mm-hmm. and they start getting a little threatened by that.
Mm-hmm. That goes to a good point. That's another type of bully. We call it like the two-headed serpent. On the one hand, they're trying to befriend you. And usually it's the person that befriends you first when you come to an office. But at the same time, they're backstabbing you. So they're trying to get information about you to use against you. And one of the keys that Dr. Namni said, he said, don't self-disclose. Don't share a lot of information. Kind of watch people. Because what they do, they take that and they use it against you. So you have to be careful of coworkers who are so quick to embrace you. I mean, not that you have to be, you know, standoffish or anything, but you are in a work environment, and you have to understand, as I call, the lay of the land, and know who makes decisions and who the team players are and who aren't, you know.
And you have to continue to try to be professional.
Yes.
And then I look like the factory. Let's talk quickly about the factory, and I want to talk about how your faith really helped you mm-hmm. get over this hump.
Yes.
I mean, because it was a heck of a hump to get over. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was dry. I mean, workplace bullying could really drive you crazy, especially if you say, I got to keep this job. I got to stay in it. I got to support my family. I got to, you know, all of the reasons we should stay in it, mm-hmm. but it's causing harm.
Yes. And there are extreme cases where people have committed suicide. They have actually committed suicide. You have hypertension, you have heart attacks and strokes because of all the stress on a job. So I know I was at the point where I wanted to quit. And I'll never forget that day. I was sitting alone in the conference room. And I am a woman of faith. And I was just kind of thinking to myself, I was like, you know, I'm tired. I just want to quit. Because after so long, sometimes you can't be the Hulk and turn into the Hulk all the time. It's draining. You know, you get tired of being frustrated. And I'll never forget, I heard the Holy Spirit say, you can't quit. This is your proving ground. You have to fight and defeat the giants and the bears in your life, just like others have. And so that was my turning point. And I used the power of forgiveness, the power of prayer, and the power of praise to transform my spirit. And just to show you, I went full circle with that same person that was bullying me. When we had a changeover in our management, he was being targeted, and he was being undermined and sabotaged and mistreated. And I didn't know other people were being sabotaged, or little things that were happening with the whole staff, and it was happening with me. And so I was documenting things, and so the Lord's like, you have to speak up. You need to speak. Now, this is after I've gone through my transformation. And so I brought
and
it up.
You had the anger management class.
Exactly. Which I didn't even have to use, but because I was able to control my spirit and my emotions. And you have to take yourself out of it.
That's part of it right there.
Yes.
Control, self-control.
Exactly. And you have to know that it's really not personal. It can be, but it's really not. And then you look, when you are a person of faith, it's really not that individual just picking on you. There is a force behind it. And that's kind of some of the things that I talk about in the book, is identifying that source and being in a place where you can forgive. And when that same bully needs your help, you're able to help them. And so I was able to speak up and make it so that everyone else could voice their opinions. And I did it in a very controlled and professional way.
Oh, that's great. And it's a surprise sometime. But, you know, I'll never forget. I mean, this thing with me went on about 2 years, really. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I tried to get around it. I ended up working harder to make sure things were right. You know, the guy was supposed to help get my programs for my plays and everything. He was supposed to do that. He was getting paid to do that and wasn't doing it. Mm-hmm. But I had to have the program, so I'm hustling around making sure that, because at the end of the day, my name is that. Yeah. I'm the out front person. So I don't know. I just have to say, I had to set a standard for my students. I didn't want them to come and anything was just half done and things of that nature, because I believe that we teach by everything we do.
Exactly.
Everything we do, we teach. So I'll never forget. The assistant principal had us all in this little back room to talk about it. By that time, I had already turned into Black Woman and all of this stuff. My super heroine. But one of the men started crying. And I didn't feel bad whatsoever. Because I ran into a lady who did not know me. Who said, I heard you teach at Southfield. That same teacher had helped her son skip a lot of time. Didn't even say, you don't have to be in class. Let him hang out in the auditorium. This before I came. That son didn't graduate on time. So that guy had a lot. We have another call. Good morning.
I'm going to just ask your guest that I heard her say about the source. Do you find competition for position and wages and to stay on the job because of the cutback is the primary source of the work class of bullying? I'm going to hang up and listen.
Okay. Yes, the way that an organization is structured definitely, and the culture of that organization definitely plays to how the environment is ripe for bullying. Many times you will have people, supervisors, or even the structure is set up where they're jockeying for a position. They intentionally set people against each other to make them work harder. And they may not, they may choose someone else, but they're getting a lot of work out of you and you're sitting there undermining each other. And it's so, I'm glad that you said that, because there are a lot of successful companies who set a culture that do not pit each other against one another.
Right, and it's a good culture. Mm-hmm. And everybody wants to do their best.
Yes, and then you have the, you're able to be free to focus on the client or the customer, which is key. When you're sitting there fighting each other and undermining each other, well, you're making the company look bad or your organization look bad. The work isn't really getting done, and the product that's going out is subpar. So, yes, it can be, and it really depends on the environment. I really do believe that the reason why this legislation isn't going forward is because it's pro-employer.
Right.
You know, they don't really want it. They feel that having bullying keeps people in line.
Well, it doesn't, you know, and unfortunate. It causes a culture that is very cutthroat.
And
you've
toxic.
Seen how people have gone into the workplace and massacred the workplace. They've come back. They think they've been unfairly targeted and stuff like that. Now, some of the skills that Angeline has in her book, you'll discover how to uncover your strengths in a situation like that, overcoming your weaknesses. Because sometimes we can have personal weaknesses, can't
right.
we?
Yes. And in my case, giving people the benefit of the doubt, you do that, but you have to do it with some wisdom. And as people keep saying, when people show you who they are, believe it. You know?
Right.
And, but you have to have a balance. And then just kind of trying to stay on the path, being too stubborn to say, we're going to work together. Well, sometimes that's just not going to work. And you have to know when to say, okay, this isn't working. I've got to address it, and I've got to do something different. So, yes, looking at your strengths, working within your strengths, overcoming your weaknesses, and using the power of forgiveness is very pivotal.
And she also has strategies to identify strongholds. What are that? What's that?
Well, a stronghold is when there is a a position, whether in your spirit or it can be within your organization, that hinders the movement, hinders you from moving forward, and it just keeps you stagnant. And you have to be able to recognize, like a company would call it a bottleneck. You have to be able to identify those areas, like when the gatekeeper is keeping stuff backed up. That's, she has a stronghold in what you're trying to do. And so you need to be able to identify that. And I say a little prayer, and I share it in the book. I say a little prayer that says, make my adversary my advocate. And it's just a simple prayer. And when you pray and you believe and you know that God hears you, he'll answer it. And I've had plenty of times when I've tried to get things from people and they were being, you know, kind of obstructive or rude or whatever, and I'll just keep praying in my spirit. And they'll end up helping me and giving me everything that I needed. So, you know.
And, you know, sometimes you never know what these people might admire your skills, mm-hmm. but they don't even know how to say it.
Yeah. And many times they don't know who they are.
Absolutely.
I've dealt with other women who they wanted to undermine me, but at the same time, they would mock everything that I did. You know, so that let me know, okay, so they're watching me. And so sometimes you just have to, like I say, like the book says, position yourself to be in a place to where you can help them, because many times they do have issues at home. Many times their house is just in disarray.
Well, sometimes those people don't have power in their home, and they come there.
Yes.
They need a place where they can have some power.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And to domineer and to feel like they're in control of something when really they're not. And sometimes many people understand this is the person, and they just work around them, you know. And I would say I had the opportunity to present this same topic to AT&T. They have a wellness workplace program. So now you see a shift in the workplace to where employers recognize there's too much absenteeism. Our workers are not healthy, and it's costing us on our health care and things like that. So now they're kind of instituting more wellness in the workplace, and meditation and mindfulness, experiencing gratitude, keeping a journal. Those are other strategies that you can
do. That is called workplace life, work life, mm-hmm. Having a good work life, mm-hmm. because work is a big part of your lives. I went to a conference at the University of Wisconsin, and it was all about that, mm-hmm. how to make the workplace life of your people good so that you all can accomplish more.
Yes.
You know? Mm-hmm. So where can we get your book, Angeline? This is Position for Power, The Working Woman's Guide to Thriving in Life. And I think this could be the working man's guide too.
Yes.
Because I know it happens. I know you've seen so many things on the job where men have just fought back too.
Yes. Well, you can get it at positioned4power.com, and you can get it there, and it's on Amazon, so you can download it on your phone or you can order a paperback copy.
Right, that's great. Angeline Lawrence. Angeline, like an angel. A-N-G-E-L-I-N-E. Yeah, Lawrence. And this is a much needed book, and it's also a book that, it's something that everyone needs.
Yes.
Because being bullied on the workplace just adds an albatross on your back.
It does. And you know the old saying, you come home and you kick the cat, you know, and yell at the kids. And that's not the type of lifestyle that I don't think anyone would want.
No.
You don't invest in your education and take the time to learn your skill just to be upset all the time, you know. So this helps you regain your quality of life. And what I've discovered is that in applying these principles, that it has helped me to overcome anything, any type of obstacle. I do the same process, the same strategies. So it goes beyond bullying. It's just about your quality of life.
Right. And that's so important. That's so important. So, Angeline, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. And we'll be back in just a moment, because I want, if any of you want to call in and talk about JD, we can do that. So I'll be back in just a moment. I am back. And once again, if you didn't hear the announcement earlier, Mr. J.D. Hill of the J.D. Hill Show and owner of African Easy Silk Hair Care Products made his transition yesterday afternoon, Sunday afternoon. And we asked you to send the prayers out to his family and to people here at the station who really love J.D. Hill. He was just such a nice man, always had something good to say. And if you have anything that you'd like to say about J.D., please call in and talk about it. I have some other things that I was going to talk about, but I mean, if you don't call in, I can go on and talk about them. But J.D., what was important to me was to see that he cared so much about young people starting to do something, trying to run their businesses, get their own businesses. And you see nowadays, there's so many people who have their own businesses. I was reading something during the night. Like I said, I woke up so early. They have these 10 businesses that are trying to win $25,000. And 8 of the 10, I believe, were African-American businesses. These are young people who are stepping out there attempting to be entrepreneurs. It's very important. A lot of people left corporate and they've decided to work for themselves, create their own thing. And that takes a lot of courage. But J.D. said that, you know, if you get out there and you could start, it's about working hard. And he worked hard. We have a call. Good morning. Good morning.
So how you doing today?
I'm doing okay.
First, I'd like to give a shout out to TV33, R.J. Watkins, yourself, Ms. Perryman, Ms. Colette, all the other show hosts, Mr. Jones, Burke Jones. I'm calling about, I'm sorry to hear about what happened to J.D. Hill. This is DJ Bob International Hip Hop. And J.D. Hill is the one that turned me on to TV33. So, you know, I will always have mad love for Mr. J.D. Hill. And J.D. Hill is a very positive influence for TV33 over the last 10 years.
Yes.
I'm very sorry about hearing about his loss.
Yes. Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
And like I said, all other TV show hosts, and TV, I didn't mean to interrupt you there. But all of the TV shows, DJ Bow, International Hip Hop, have mad love for all y'all. But, you know, this is a sad moment for TV 33. Because J.D. Hill did a lot. J.D. Hill supported many different TV shows. J.D. Hill started a lot of individuals into their own businesses.
Absolutely.
From, Easy Silk Hair Care Products.
Absolutely.
Hosted their own TV shows. And also, when it came down to EEOC, some of the concepts of International Hip Hop came from him. Because I started National Hip Hop about 10 years ago, and that's right around the time when I used to go all the way over to the east side to his church services he used to have off of East Warren. So I would like all the people who really have mad love for J.D. Hill just to call in right now and say something.
Well, we have the lines are lit, and I really appreciate it. And mad love to you too.
All right.
Thank you. Bye bye. Good morning.
Yes, good morning. J.D. Hill was a man that I respected highly. He was a rare businessman. And he was a guy that one of the talk show hosts that I can respect by him. He didn't have a hidden agenda. Many times when he'd be conducting a show, me and him he was the only talk show host would air his views in opposition to mine, and I would air my views opposition to his. He's the only one. That means he didn't have no hidden agenda. And I highly respect him because I learned some things from J.D. too. I learned that some things I thought was right. In the course of our debate, he showed me where I wasn't so right. And that's why I looked at him, what he shows that he supported. He supported people who had opposite views than he did. He was a person that showed, not in words, but in deeds, his love for this community. And I'm going to miss him highly.
Us too. Thank you, Tyrone.
Okay.
Bye-bye. Good morning. Hello? Speak up. I can't hear you.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. I just wanted to express my condolences for the passing of J.D. Hill. I really, really enjoyed him. I watched him all the time. He just had so much knowledge. I mean, this guy, he didn't have to have college degrees and PhDs and all that, but he had what we call common sense.
And Mother common wit. Sense is not common, you know.
You're right. But he had it. And I would listen to him all the time, and I would just get so much out of what he would say. I mean, I remember him saying things like the hungry dog in the meat house and all these kind of sayings that kind of, you know, reflected back to something like my grandparents who raised me would talk like that. But those little sayings, the little anecdotes had a lot to go through. I mean, if you listen to them, they had a lot of meaning. And I am going to really, really miss him because I kept following. I kept calling the station asking how he was doing. I remember he came back on during the time he'd just gotten from surgery or whatever, and he was not looking really well, but he struggled in to try to give everybody some confidence on how to beat what he had. You know, he came, he was very candid about how he was going, how he went through his illness and everything with everyone. And he was just a guy that really cared about other people to the very end. And I want his relatives and also his spirit to know that we really, really appreciated him.
Absolutely, absolutely. And he really cared about young people. He was always respectful. That was another thing. Don't you agree? Oh, well, she hung up. But, yeah, J.D. was always respectful to everyone. No matter who he met, he was just respectful. Just a very nice man. But he would also tell you his history. And I think of him being with his mother, because you know his mother just died like a year ago, and now he's with her. Good morning. Hello? Good morning. Somebody's on the line, I guess. But I guess they hung up. I guess they didn't hear me. But anyway, I think about the fact that he had gotten his hair cut. And he said, my sisters made me cut my hair for my mother's funeral when he went down. And how he talked about how he was raised. And I don't know much about his family life. I don't know hardly anything. But I know that he was one that cared about the community a great deal. Now, remember, I believe it's today at 11, from 11 to 12, the hair doctor is going to be on, and he's going to give a tribute to J.D. And also, think about it, J.D. and the African Easy Silk hair products. Think about all the people who were involved in that and who's selling that, Malik and so forth. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Oh, I'm fine, thanks.
You know, I just heard about J.D. Hill. I'm just so sad to hear that. I first met him at a Canton Spiritual concert, and after that, every time he would say, that's my Canton Spiritual buddy. So that's what he called me, his Canton Spiritual buddy. And from time to time, we would talk, and he would call me or whatever. But he was just such a good guy. I mean, you know, I've just been crying and stuff ever since I heard it. And I'd be back and forth down south, so I didn't know he had really gotten back into being that ill. You know, but I just, you might think I'm lying. Yesterday, I said, I'm going to get J.D. Hill a get well card. And when I went to the store and come back, you know, I heard that he had passed. So I'm just so saddened by it. so I'm going to have to get off the phone because I'm going to cry again.
Oh, please.
You all have a good day.
We'll keep you informed. Thank you. Good morning.
Hey, Ms. Perryman.
Hi.
Yeah, you know, this is 6'4 again.
I know. Hi, 6'4.
And, you know, I know it's sad for a lot of people because of what J.D. Hill meant to us. And this is why we have to celebrate who J.D. Hill was as an individual.
Absolutely.
The greatness that man had brought to these airways.
Absolutely.
The concepts of African independence and the idea that you could do this. This ain't a day to be sad.
Yes.
This is a day that you rejoice that God has allowed you to run across a man like J.D. Hill, and that man had installed something in you that's going to outlive him in you. The man had came to you like Christ with the answer. And oftentimes, Ms. Perryman, people, spirits like that are grossly underappreciated.
Right.
And we use moments like this to say, you wrap your arms around the J.D. Hills who come to you in life.
Yes.
Because if you, like Tyrone said, the man didn't have no motive, no other motive that you become successful on your own.
Right.
This is a person who rightfully so should take his place amongst the greats.
Absolutely.
His work. Great, Jesus said, greater works. You will do in my name. He said you will do great. I think J.D. Hill done greater than that. Because I met him about 8 times at the station one time throughout the years.
Uh-huh.
And I took him to lunch one time. We sat a few times and talked. And I used to tell him, man, I'm just a student when I'm around you. Because he has so much. And I told him one day, I said, man, I'm going to get with you on that African Easy Show. Because I could not believe that there was a black man who had such a product and was coming to his people with it. And I told my people, I said, man, the moment we get some money freed up, that is our next project.
Absolutely. Well, 6'4", I got about 2 minutes. I have one more person on the line. I really appreciate it. And you'll be able to call back if you're around between 11 and 12. And maybe some of the other hosts will be talking about him also. Thank you so much, 6'4".
Thank you for taking my call again, Ms. Perry.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, Brenda. How are you?
Hi.
And I just want to call in and offer my condolences and my sympathies, you know, in regards to J.D. and his family. I mean, the man was, he was a pillar in the community, especially in terms of what he was doing with the EEOC.
Right.
And, you know, all I can say is, you know, my best to his family. And, I mean, you know, let's go ahead and celebrate what the man did. I mean, you know,
yes.
Death is hard.
Yes.
But, you know, you can see I can't find words. But anyway,
I know, Tom. I know.
You know, like I said, he was a man that, you know, believed, you know, he walked the walk and he talked the talk.
He certainly did.
You know, the last, you know, few days, months, or whatever it was that he was completely, which I'm pretty sure it was, he was completely satisfied with himself and what he tried to do, you know, for this community.
Well, God bless him. I know he's looking down at us now. So I got to wrap up, but thank you so much.
Okay, thanks for
taking the call. And we'll probably be doing this most of the day. So I'll talk to you later. Thank you. Everybody, pray for JD's family. And join me this coming Friday at 9 and 10 for my shows. Thank you. Now we have Theo coming up next. I'll see you in a moment.
You're watching W33BY, Detroit, Highland Park, Michigan.